Now,
E ora,
it's a moment many of us have been waiting
momento
for.
che molti di noi
He's
hanno
not only
atteso,
one of our best friends,
non
he's
soltanto
the co-founder
uno dei nostri
of
migliori
Arduino,
amici, ma
he's
il
the
co-creator
of the Raw Maker Faire, and he's the only unique wizard of the makers. Please welcome
maker.
Massimo Banzi.
Diamo il benvenuto a Massimo Banzi.
Hi everybody. Welcome.
Buongiorno
to
a tutti, benvenuti al Mera Maker
Faire.
And I want
to talk a little bit about
some of the
work that we are doing
del lavoro che stiamo
around
facendo.
The theme of connected devices, which is my way of saying
di
Internet of Things, which I don't like.
Collegati,
so
un modo
devices.
Di parlare dell'internet delle cose.
I want to start with some of the things that people have been talking about for many, many years
di cose
regarding
di cui
this idea
parla
that objects
anni,
and things around us will be connected to the Internet. We've been talking about it for a long time.
A noi saranno connessi
and this is a screenshot from a video, from like the 80s about this amazing connected refrigerators. And you know, right now,
collegato.
There are these connected refrigerators that are not... They're not available, people don't have them, you know, so people, engineers have been talking about it for many, many years, but we don't have them. So there are blogs like this
sono
one,
stati progettati, però
which basically
li ha.
Are sort of loudly commenting on the fact that there's no connected fridge.
Che non ci sono
and
I
think
it's, anche se gli ingegneri li hanno progettati.
To me it starts one
per
reflection on this idea that sometimes people get together and they think, you know, technology is gonna, you just need technology to solve all the problems. And then you can just push technology to people and people will just adopt it and then just go with it.
And
actually, a lot of these products, then they never materialize because they're not designed with human beings. They're designed just with the technology in mind. And one example of this kind of controversial relationship between the technology and the home is this Honeywell home computer from the 60s.
Computer Honeywell degli anni 60.
There's a piece missing in the picture. So the picture is missing the punchline of the ad is that if only she could cook as well as Honeywell can compute. So part of the stupidity of the way they talk about technology and the role of the woman in life.
I was happy to
discover later on that Honeywell never sold one of these computers.
And
I'm glad that it didn't work out for them in this particular case. So, you know, there's a lot of pictures. You know, even Olivetti had these ad campaigns in the 70s where you would see like people lying in a bathtub with like a computer, like a 1960s computer next to the bathtub. You know?
So, vasca con il computer.
And again, these are scenarios that never really materialize, as these people imagine. But this idea that connected objects are sort of the next big thing is clear if you look at this picture. This is the Gartner curve, or where the different technologies are in their kind of hype cycle. And at the moment, the Internet of Things is the most hyped technology there is. So you see by the graph that in the near future is going to crash badly, and then slowly it's going to pick up and become something that we can really have with us every day. So these are some numbers about the number of devices. There will be the amount of devices that people will have and how many the connected devices. This is from 2011. I'm sure it's still is less than the actual number that will actually materialize. There are numbers that indicate that these connected devices will be part of our life. And so there are some indications that the DIY smart home market, which is what I guess interests a lot the makers, will be worth $7.8 billion by 2019, which is a very big number. But it's worth already $1.3 billion now. So there is still a market for, you know, building your own connected home based on your
costruire la casa collegata sulla base delle nostre idee, dei nostri interessi, invece di quello che
vogliono farci what's happening right now in IoT, which I find really funny, is the fact that every big company is getting together in this massive consortium,
cercando di mettersi insieme per creare dei grandi consorsi, perché ce ne sono più di uno.
And basically the message is always the same: we are all getting together, we're taking care of everything, don't worry about it, just get our solution, it will work, it will be perfect, you don't have to think about it. Actually, my objective is to tell you that you need to think about it, because if we don't think about it and we don't steer these changes and we are not in charge of the change, a lot of bad things will happen to us. So if you look at the number of consortia, I took a few pictures of a number of them. So this is a medium-sized one, a larger-sized one, German. Then a huge-sized consortia. They removed the icons, but they couldn't fit all the names in the page. And then you have another consortium, and then you have the UK consortium. But, you know, if you're not careful, what's going to happen is that you are the product.
Now,
if everything connected around you, so one of the examples I was making in New York is, imagine if you flush the toilet and suddenly there's like a number of messages are sent around the internet, kind of capturing that instant in your life, and then processing that information, you know, and then the objects around you are starting to react on the fact that you actually went to the bathroom. I think that would be really disturbing for me. But this is what happens when you become the product, when your information are freely shared between big companies normally. And also there are even more scary scenarios, like this is an actual quote from the chief of the CIA, will spy you through your dishwasher. So I unplugged my dishwasher at home, so it's not working
attraverso le lavatrici.
I think I just
allora
wash
io ho praticamente oppure la lavapiatti.
And I also
io
gave up on ironing because apparently in Russia they found a bunch of irons coming from China that actually contained this Wi-Fi spying device. So when somebody plugged them into the power in order to iron their clothes, this will start to capture all the Wi-Fi network around
them.
So we started to think about what could be a way, an Arduino way towards connected devices. So we used as an example the slow food movement that in Italy is very popular. It's also popular all around the world, but it's in a way started in the 1980s also as a kind of reaction to the arrival of fast food and McDonald's, and in a way to kind of bring back some values, so good, clean and fair are the three kind of key values of food. That's important for this movement. So we try to figure out how they translate into technology. So in a way for us, open source is a way to be good. This idea that everything that we open, some, at least the key technologies are open so that we can see what's going on.
And
open source also is one of the elements that protect you for some of the things that are happening right now. It happened to me a couple of times now that I got a software that I really, really liked, and then one morning they say, hi, we've been bought by Google and we're shutting down tomorrow morning.
I really liked you.
You were very useful to me, and now you're gone like this.
Purtroppo.
So in a way, you know, open source at least protects you a little bit from these things happening. And in a way, as Arduino, you know, we've been creating a lot of open source standards. This is a bunch of boards made by companies who make several billion dollars a year, but they like the idea of kind of making products the way, you know, a much smaller company does. And again, for example, the other value is clean. So in a way, clean for me means also being concerned about the long-term user experience and sustainability. You know, we used to have these products that we loved and we cared for, and now we're actually moving, you know, into a space where we are constantly in a way invited to buy new stuff,
why
certain objects that we have are perfectly good. So can we figure out ways where we can make sure that if a product loses its service, because every connected object has a service attached to it, can we figure out ways where we can reuse this object in a different service? Can we give it a longer life?
In
a way, fair for me is essentially what I said before. Making sure that at least if you're not the product, or if you are the product, at least in a way there is something for you in it, so you have a little bit more control
of what happens to your data, to your information.
I think this is important. So, you know, as Arduino, we are trying to work on this cloud. I'm not going to go into this many details, but we're trying to work on how we create a cloud for connected objects, which is open, easy to use.
Che sia aperto, facile da utilizzare.
So this is a little bit technical, allora, and how that electronics is so smart that people can start assembling connected devices at home without really being a developer. So what is the next level of going beyond the Arduino tools and making them even less reliant on you being able to program obscure and complicated languages? And also building a safe cloud, so we just announced with Atmel this Wi-Fi module that has an encryption module, hardware encryption Wi-Fi built into the device. So it's very, very difficult. It's a lot more difficult than to crack than, in a way, a software encryption that normally is in a number of devices. Okay, some devices don't even have that. Somebody was able to run Doom on a Canon printer because they realized there is no protection. You can load whatever software you want in the printer. So safety is important.
But, you know,
okay, we say congratulations. But in a way, for me, it was very, very important to figure out a way where we can actually test this technology with human beings, where people can actually live with this kind of stuff. And so we worked on this Arduino connected apartment. It's a temporary name. We gave ourselves the promise that by Sunday morning we will have a final name, but it's we're still debating. There have been many homes of the future. Every big company has made the home of the future. And it's always an exhibition where actually nobody lives there.
So
it's actually a fake thing. No? There's a home of the future, but it's fake.
Sono case
so we are creating
false.
This apartment by taking a piece of the office we have in Torino and turning it into an apartment where we're working with the curator, Bruce Sterling. You can see Bruce moving a washing machine at San Salvario,
an area of Torino.
I mean, he's well-known, futurist, writer.
So he's going to be the curator of this apartment.
And then Lorenzo Romagnoli is our interaction designer, resident maker, so he's going to be making every day, and they're going to be publishing whatever they do in that space. The idea is to combine some of the classic ideas of Italian design, digital fabrication and open source electronics, because we have a Fab Lab, the first Fab Lab in Italy, actually, on the ground floor, underneath this apartment.
We
have Italian open source design, but also open source design from other different countries, so the furniture is going to be open source, the technology is going to be open source, and you will be able to rent the apartment for brief periods on Airbnb. So you can actually, if you want to actually live in that world, you can actually get yourself a seat and spend some time and participate in the creation of these technologies. So I would say, you know, check it out. We are making a presentation.
Noi faremo una presentazione per spiegarvi il progetto sabato mattina. Se avete la possibilità, venite a sentire.
Sì,
è a Torino, venite a vederlo. Grazie.
It's good to be an Airbnb again. Yes. So we can rent an apartment.
Yes. Okay. So at least
so real people can use
quindi persone vere possono utilizzare l'appartamento, possono vivere all'interno come un bed and breakfast.
Just a closing line about this Maker
una
fair.
Battuta su questa Maker Faire. Abbiamo cominciato nel 2008 in un bar di Milano.
Sei
anni fa. E adesso questa grande Maker Faire. Che significa questa cosa per te?
Incredibile, credo che sia incredibile pensare che qualche anno fa pensavamo
sarebbe stato fantastico poter avere il Maker Faire in Europa, prima poi in Italia. E siamo riusciti a far partire questo percorso, siamo partiti con una conferenza di 400 persone, poi la Maker Faire con 35.000 persone. Qual è l'obiettivo quest'anno? Non lo so, non lo dico, non si dice, lo diciamo alla fine. Almeno 50.000, diciamo così, 50.000, almeno, ma almeno. Ma è un, okay. Diciamo, è un...
Thank you so much.